Now, no final edits are being executed. Not yours, not your dependencies, not even the JDKs. Maybe the most interesting tidbit about this technology is the reason for why it wasn't already removed. There are a few technologies that projects on Java 11 or older might still be using but are already removed. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to go over all Java functionality that's deprecated for removal and what you need to do to prepare your code bases. No, don't leave. Look, I know it's not as thrilling as talking about fancy new features like we did in the last episode, but it needs to be done. I want all your projects to be ready to move to the next Java version you choose, whether that's 17, 20 in March or 21 in September. And for that, you need to know about these things. To make this a bit more entertaining, I'll show you all my displays, so you can judge me for my taste, okay? And if you make it all the way to the end, I'll tell you some personal news about this space I'm sitting in. Deal? Then let's dive right in. Oh, I forgot to turn on the blue and yellow lights. How German of me. Better late than never, though. Before we get into specific deprecations, we need to quickly talk about JDeprScan. That's a command line tool that scans class files or jars for users of deprecated API elements. Very helpful, you should definitely familiarize yourself with it if you haven't already, there's a link in the description. Now importantly, you can run JDeprScan from the latest JDK release against code compiled from much older Java versions and still get up-to-date deprecation warnings. So for example, if your codebase compiles against Java 11, you can and should run JDeprScan from JDK 19 to see deprecations as they are defined in 19. Keep this in mind whenever I talk about deprecated APIs. You can easily find static uses of them in your codebase and in your dependencies with JDeprScan. As an aside, be aware that since JDK 9, the javadoc deprecated page has a section that lists the APIs that are deprecated for removal. If you find use of deprecated APIs in your code, you obviously have to remove them. I will make sure to mention appropriate alternatives in each section. If you find them in your dependencies, see whether you can file a ticket, provide additional information, offer a bounty, or open a pull request. And make sure you're using recent versions of these dependencies so you can easily update to a fixed one when it's released. Nobody's using the applet API anymore, right? So no need to spend a lot of time on this. It was deprecated by JEP 289 in Java 9, with for removal set to true by JEP 398 in JDK 17. Maybe the most interesting tidbit about this technology is the reason for why it wasn't already removed. And that is its use in roughly 1,500 functional tests across Swing 2D and AWT that happen to be written as applets without having anything to do with them. Progress on removing these tests has been slow and won't be done anytime soon. The Security Manager backstory is long and complicated. It's laid out in detail in JEP 411 and summarized in newscast number 5, so here's the overly simplified, tweet-sized version. The Security Manager played its role in Java security architecture in the past, but has lost efficacy over time as new threats replaced old ones. What remains impairs performance, is difficult and brittle to use, often surpassed by lower level or out of process mechanisms, and hence rarely used. And while it does little to improve the ecosystem's overall security, it has a noticeable maintenance cost for the OpenJDK community, particularly for those responsible for security. So it was deprecated for removal in Java 17. The OpenJDK community has been focused on removing direct dependencies of JDK code on the Security Manager or its APIs, for example from JStatD or JMX. As mentioned in 2022's last newscast, they've also added callAs and current to subject as replacement for doAs and getSubject. Overall, the people working on the Security Manager's removal have a good understanding of how its APIs should be degraded once support is actually removed, but there is no timeline for that yet. JEP 411's future work section mentions a few use cases such as securing access to native code, which are currently often implemented by abusing the by creatively applying the Security Manager. Some progress has been made, for example, Panama's foreign function API offers various safeguards and improvements over JNI. Read more on that specifically in the safety section of JEP 434. And there has been some research into other use cases, but it's too early to say which of them, if any, will get replacement APIs. To evaluate your use of the Security Manager, check whether your app calls System.SetSecurityManager and look out for the system property java.security.manager. For example, a launch script might set it to the class name of a custom Security Manager. If neither is the case, you're not using the Security Manager and are good to go. If you do set the Security Manager though, you need to investigate what exactly you're using it for, whether that is still timely and what alternatives exist. Carefully read JEP 411 for all of that. I last looked into value-based classes shortly after Java 8 came out, but when I read JEP 390, which was integrated in JDK 16 for this episode, I noticed that there are a number of very interesting changes and that overall there's quite a lot to talk about, more than I can squeeze in today. So I decided to cover it in detail in a future episode and cut this section here really short. Basically, first, rely on deprecation warnings or use JDepperScan to discover calls to the constructors of the 8 primitive wrapper classes and replace them with calls to their static factory methods. So for example, integer value of instead of new integer. Second, avoid synchronization on value-based classes like optional or the primitive wrapper classes. You can find them with the corresponding compiler warnings or the diagnostic VM option diagnose sync on value-based classes, both introduced in JDK 16. If you set the option to 2, you get a lock message every time the VM synchronizes on a value-based class instance. And if you set it to 1, you get a fatal error instead. For the backstory and more details, read JEP 390 or subscribe for the episode I'll make on this. Finalization is Java's OG resource management mechanism and has been around since its first release. Unfortunately, it has a number of undesired properties. It's always on, has unpredictable latency, behavior in the finalizer methods is unconstrained, and neither threading nor ordering can be controlled. This leads to a difficult programming model, security vulnerabilities, unreliable execution, and subpar performance. So no wonder it was deprecated for removal in Java 18. And this was just the short version. For the slightly longer one, watch Inside Java Newscast number 15. For the full version, read JEP 421. The OpenJDK community is removing finalize methods one by one, and if I counted correctly, it went from 104 in JDK 8 to 61 in JDK 19. Progress, but definitely still a way to go. And while I don't have insight into how the removed ones were selected, I can tell you how I tackle such tasks, and it's not by solving the hardest problems first. So my personal guess is that the actual removal is still sometime in the future. At this point, you should be removing finalize methods from your project. You can find them with JDepperScan, of course, but if you don't have access to all code running in your application, you can also run it with Java Flight Recorder enabled and look out for the finalizer statistics event. The primary replacement for finalizers are try with resources blocks. Otherwise, you may have to use the cleaner API. Check the aforementioned Inside Java Newscast or JEP for details. If finalizers remain, but you're wondering how your project would be impacted if they're ignored, run it with the command line option finalization disabled. Now, no finalizers are being executed. Not yours, not your dependencies, not even the JDKs. Compared to a run without that option, a close look at memory profiles for heap and native memory, as well as statistics from buffer pool mxbean and Unix operating system and mxbean get open file descriptor count, should reveal whether there are any issues mounting up. If they all look good, you have some assurance that your application will not be impacted by the eventual removal of finalization. There are a few technologies that projects on Java 11 or older might still be using but are already removed. The concurrent mark sweep garbage collector was removed in 14. In most cases, G1 is an equivalent or better replacement. The JavaScript engine NASHORN was removed in 15, but continues to exist as a standalone project. There's a link to their GitHub in the description. RMI activation was removed in 17. Nobody seems to be using it anymore, and as far as I'm aware, there is no alternative technology. Biased locking was deprecated for removal and deactivated in 16 and removed in 18. You can still use it on 16 and 17 with the option used bias locking, but unless your code executes a lot of uncontested synchronized operations, which is almost exclusive to pre-Java 1.2 code, you won't see a performance benefit from turning it on. And that's it for deprecated and removed technologies. You made it! See? It wasn't that bad. Did you like the displays? Which one was your favorite? So about those news. I've been working in this room for over 6 years now and that was okay. It did its job well, but it's also pretty small and boring. Both on camera and just to be in 10 hours a day. So I'm really looking forward to my new office slash studio that I will move into over the next weeks. Expect me to show you around 3 episodes from now. The next episode will be done by my colleague, Anna Maria Mihalceanu, and the one after that, I'll take you on vacation again. And that's it for today on the Inside Java Newscast. Do all the YouTube things and say hi to Anna for me in 2 weeks. So long!